CIA has explained it to us. It said they come here and they want to do us harm because we're bombing them. What is the whole world about the drone being in Iran? And we're begging and pleading, and how are we going to start a war to get this drone back? Why were we flying a drone over Iran? Why do we have to bomb so many countries?
Giving you in-depth political analysis, tackling the issues of the Jewish world. Here's Jake Stern on Yeshiva World Radio.
Thank you, Rick Santos. We have a very special guest coming up in a moment. We are on the yeshivaworld.com. My name is Jake Stern, jakesternradio@gmail.com. The next generation of Jewish radio, new poll numbers out of Iowa, very exciting. Rick Santorum has moved ahead of Newt Gingrich. He is at 16%. All that hard work beginning to pay off, and I don't want to take too much credit, but we mentioned last week that it looks like he may be peaking at just the right moment. We've been pushing for it with Rick Santorum, although he still does have a long way to go. We'll give you all the political analysis in the coming days leading up to the Iowa caucuses, less than a week away, and of course that'll be followed by the New Hampshire primary. But right now, let's go to our special guest. Here now on the Yeshiva World Newsmaker line, we're very excited to be joined by Eric Dondero. Eric was an advisor to Congressman Ron Paul, of course now the presidential candidate, for 12 years. His website is libertarianrepublican.net. Eric, thank you very much for being here.
It's great to be here. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, now you've decided to speak out that the time has come about Congressman Paul's radical and dangerous foreign policy beliefs. You say that he's not an anti-Semite, but you call him anti-Israel and anti-Israeli. And we all know that he has said that he would not have gone after bin Laden after 9/11. He has publicly said that many times. And you take it to a new level and say that he wouldn't have attacked Nazi Germany during World War II, would want Israel abolished, and a lot more. I'm going to let you talk and now and give us your thoughts on Ron Paul's foreign policy platform.
Okay, great. Well, I'll start off by saying I worked for the man for over a span of 15 years. I say I worked for him for 12 years. That's pretty much accurate. That you know, when you add up all the time that I was with him over a span of about 15 years, and I have to be honest, I have to be sincere in this. I racked my brain out many times before I put out the statement. I cannot remember a single instance, either in his speeches or in his personal conversations to me or to any other people around me, where he used any derogatory terms towards Jews or Jewish people or anything that could be even remotely called anti-Semitic.
And that's fine.
I have to ask you,
and I totally accept that and believe that, but I don't know that that's necessarily the criteria, the litmus test for being anti-Semitic. A person doesn't have to use slurs and derogatory remarks. That just might not be his style, his personality.
You're right. I'll grant you that. I mean, I'll go along with that. But I guess each individual needs to make up their own mind about those sorts of things.
So let me ask you a couple of points just to clarify, because I was confused. Anti-Israel, that's one thing. Anti-Israeli, that's already referring to the people of Israel. How is that not anti-Semitic?
I guess I would say that he would be anti-Zionist Israeli. Does that make sense?
It makes sense, but isn't anti-Zionist lately the new way that people have come up with to really be anti-Semitic without admitting it? Anti-Zionist. What is that? The Jews have been given the state of Israel. That is theirs. It's pretty much all we have got. They're just couching their anti-Semitism in calling it anti-Zionism. Isn't that really what's going on?
Point taken. I agree with you. I think that's a very good point. But I guess there would be, you know, an exception to the rule. There could be some Israeli person out there that just thinks that it's a bad thing that Israel exists and you know, and maybe it might be better that all Israelis move to the United States. So, I mean, you can't say that for 100%, you know, you can't say 100% anti-Israeli. So there might be a couple exceptions to that rule. I know that doesn't really make a great deal of sense, but I guess that's how I look at it.
It kind of sounds like Helen Thomas. Get out of Israel, go back to Poland. It's almost that same point. And
I mean, that's pretty much how he feels. I mean, I'll tell you, that's pretty. I'm just wanting to preface my remarks by saying that I personally never heard anything derogatory out of his mouth about Jewish people.
And again, he may have the belief and feel it deep in his heart and express it by saying all these incendiary things, like getting on the House floor and saying that Israel helped create Hamas.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I agree. I mean, I think deep down in his heart, there might be some resentment there. But that's not for me to decide. That's for, and I am Jewish. You know, on my mother's side, I was bar mitzvahed. I think each Jew, and particularly your listening audience, need to decide for themselves whether they want to apply that label anti-Semite to him or not.
Okay.
I personally choose to apply the label of anti-Israel, anti-Israeli to my former boss.
And anti-Zionist,
because anti-Zionist too. I feel comfortable in knowing, through all my conversations with him and all my discussions, I feel comfortable with that label. I don't necessarily feel comfortable in calling him an anti-Semite.
Okay.
Now, if I ever heard even once the word Jew boy come out of his lips, then I would gladly say that. Or darn Jew, or damn Jews, or something. If I ever heard that once, just one time, come out of his lips, then I would gladly apply that label to him. But I hadn't heard it. But anyway, I mean, I think the much more important issue here, and I think finally, thank God, the liberal media is finally hounding Ron about this a bit. In fact, our interview tonight is very timely, because just a few hours ago, I just caught this on the internet. One of the Weekly Standard, apparently they have a reporter that was been following Ron around and asked him repeatedly about his views on World War II and whether or not, he was very specific, whether or not if Hitler had never declared war on the United States, would the Holocaust been justification enough for the United States to intervene for humanitarian reasons? And Ron did not answer the question. And the guy asked him like three different times. And in the headline in the Weekly Standard is, Ron Paul refuses to answer a question on the World War II intervention. I'm telling you, I mean, I've had numerous discussions and vociferous arguments with him to the point where we were screaming at each other in a car, about this very topic. And he believes what he believes. He believes the only justification, he doesn't even think that Hitler declaring war on the United States was justification enough. The only time I got him to admit that we were justified in intervening in World War II was when I brought up the fact, and this is a very minor fact, but that the U-boats sunk American ships off of the U.S. coast, and actually I think it was on three different occasions U-boat crews landed on United States soil. I think it was twice in Cape Hatteras, North Carolina, and once in Long Island. I know this seems kind of obscure, but that was the only time that Ron said to me definitively that we had a right, a justification to counterattack against the Nazis.
It's really astonishing how extreme he is. Let me paint this scenario for you and try to project what he would say. Iran right now playing war games with the Straits of Hormuz. They're trying to make this statement, trying to test us and see how we respond. What would happen if they shut down the Straits of Hormuz and they suddenly caused a third of the world's oil supply to pretty much cease, caused a 350% rise in the price of oil? That would obviously create just total catastrophic situation. Would Ron Paul feel that's in the national security interest of the United States to respond?
Well, see, he would rationalize that. He would get all philosophical, and he'd say, well, you know what? Our foreign policy justifies them taking that move. So, you know, he would be inclined not to react at all. And he'd sit there and he'd say, well, why do we have U.S. ships over there in the first place? Why do we have U.S. troops on soil in the Middle East? I mean, they're justified in taking these actions, you know. They wouldn't be doing this if we didn't have troops over there.
Right, he claimed that we brought it about, like he always does. So you're actually saying that he would even consider that something that we shouldn't get involved in, even though it would just cause just an incredibly enormous economic disaster.
From what I know of his views, when I knew him, that's precisely, and what I see now on the TV and, you know, on the debates in Iowa and stuff, and what he said a couple weeks ago about this, yes, that's precisely what I'm saying. And I say this as a U.S. Navy veteran.
That's right.
And I served in the Persian Gulf, actually, for four. I was in USS Kittyhawk, an aircraft carrier, and I was also on the USS Luce, a guided missile destroyer. And on the Luce, I spent 9 months of my life in the Persian Gulf, off of Bahrain. So, you know, I know the situation quite well.
And
so
I know
what we're talking about here.
We have great respect for your service to this country. But I just want to get back to some of what I think are inconsistencies in the policy, because I understand the concept of isolationism. I certainly don't agree. Let's mind our own business. I think it's extreme and dangerous to say let's mind our business and not Iran's in creating a nuclear weapon. But I understand the concept. But then you should be consistent and say the same thing about every country. Let them do what they want. It's none of our business. But then to say, as you say, he said that he wants Israel abolished, divided up, and given back to the Arabs. He wished it didn't exist at all. That doesn't sound like isolationism. That sounds very inconsistent. That sounds like he would want to get involved and get rid of Israel. How does that make sense, again, if he's not anti-Semitic?
Let me answer that in a second. I want to rewind just
okay.
a bit, and I do want to answer that, and I get a great answer to that. But I want to rewind just a bit, and I guess I'll be saying something here on your program that I don't think I've. Man, my phone has been ringing off the hook the last couple of days.
I'm sure it
and,
has.
I've been on CNN, ABC, CBS, everything. And it's been, and people, I've been impressed. I often bash the liberal media as a conservative libertarian, and but they've been pretty nice, and they've been pretty accurate and stuff. And I think I want to say something here about my military service, and I have not told this to any other news outlet. I was the only veteran on Ron Paul's staff, besides himself, by the way. He is a veteran himself,
right.
And that should be respected.
Yes.
You know, he would use me. He would use that. He would send me off to all these VFW. Hey, if you had a rinky-dink VFW meeting, I'm a VFW member and an American Legion member, so I'm allowed to say this about my fellow VFW members or whatever. If they had like five guys meeting in a small VFW town, way out in some tiny little town in the district, he'd send me out there purposely to go to that meeting, and because he knew that I was hardcore in defense and I was pro-military and everything like that, and it would confuse a lot of our constituents. He'd send out mailings and such, oh, I'm red, white, and blue, I'm pro-American, stuff like that, and that's why he got reelected all the time, is because he kind of confused the constituency in Congressional District 14. So I resent that a little bit. After all these years, I look back at that, and I said, I was the only veteran on his staff for all those years, and he used me to give him cover, to make it seem like he was, you know, pro-America and all this. And he did this on the Jewish front, too. And I know I'm getting away from your question here.
That's fine. We'll get back to it. I want to hear this.
we had a few Jews in our district. I mean, not many, but they existed. There's one Jewish synagogue in Victoria. And it's quite a big-sized synagogue, too. And then there's a tiny, tiny little synagogue in Wharton, Texas. And they only had like 20 members or something like that. He made damn sure that I would go to those services all the time. And there was this one Jewish lawyer in Wharton, and he was a real liberal guy. He was a funny guy, great guy. and he made damn sure that everybody in that district knew that he had a Jewish staffer, you know, and he would send me off to all these meetings and everything. He'd send me off to these in Houston, and Houston wasn't in our congressional district. Send me off to Houston, all the Jewish meetings and stuff like that to confuse the situation.
I want to be clear, you know, here. What do you mean confuse? What was he trying to confuse people about?
Well, because he was attacked even back then. None of this is new. It's new to the big media.
Right, it's only new to the New York Times and CNN. It's not new to any of us who follow politics.
But it's not news to those of us who've been with Ron for many, many years involved in his congressional campaign.
Right.
In 1995, we had a vicious battle. We had a Democrat, I swear to God, his name was Lefty Morris. Believe that or not, his name was a Democrat named Lefty. He got the name from a baseball base or something like that. This guy was, oh my God, he was vicious. And he had a lot of money, and he had a lot of backing from the Democrats in Washington, and they threw everything they had at Ron, and they uncovered this whole newsletter thing back in 1996. And it's in the Dallas Morning News. It's in the Austin American Statesman. Anybody can go back and see all this. So I'm just reliving now what I've relived like three or four different times with Ron. And we've gone through this over and over again. So one time, even Lefty had a bunch of protesters come to the Holiday Inn in Victoria holding signs and saying, Ron Paul is, you know, an anti-Semite and all this, and, you know, and this was in 1996 in conservative Victoria, Texas, so none of this is new. In order to counter that, he prominently displayed me on his staff.
So he used you to put up this facade because there was the sentiment that he was anti-Jewish and anti-Semitic. You were his go-to guy to kind of fend that off.
Yep, I was indeed. And, I let myself be used because I thought at the time Ron's heart was in the right place. He was certainly good on the issues that I cared about, like abolishing the IRS and legalizing marijuana, and the domestic libertarian agenda, one is superb. And those are the issues that I cared about. And I thought I could just over time win him over on the foreign policy. And I think I did for a while. I mean, here's another thing I have told a lot of reporters today who've called. Ron did moderate in the 1990s, 1995, 1996, 97, 98. He did become sort of Mr. Republican, you know. And he was playing the game very well, and I credit myself to that, and not myself, but Tom Lizardo, the chief of staff, Michael Quinn Sullivan, the press secretary at the time. We were like mainline Republican types, so libertarian Republicans that are mainstream, and we pulled Ron away from that fringe. We were successful for a few years, but then we got hammered. I mean, and after 9/11. You know, he just went way out, once again, out into the kooky fringe land, and Lou Rockwell took over and all that, and I got kind of cast off to the side, and that's why I finally resigned. I knew that I wasn't going to win him back to the mainstream view on foreign policy, and so it was hopeless.
Jake Stern, so. Yeshiva World Radio, on our Yeshiva World Newsmaker line, we are joined by Eric Dondero, LibertarianRepublican.net, and as he was just discussing, Ron Paul, advisor for 12 years, as you were just saying, you tried to win him over, but somehow 9/11, and again, you wonder what it was about 9/11. 9/11 made all of us feel as patriotic as ever, and if anything, reinforced our belief in America and how we had to go and fight radical Islam abroad. Why would that make Ron Paul go to the other direction and become more of an isolationist?
Yes, This is weird. I call Ron sort of a reverse truther. And let me explain that. He was a truther, like, immediately, right after 9/11. Okay? He was like, the day it happened, he was already telling us staffers all sorts of crazy stuff. Oh, Bush Cheney knew about this. oh my God, now this is going to be a crackdown on all our civil liberties, and he just could not believe that a bunch of Islamists, that Muhammad Atta and 18 other Islamists flew those planes into the Twin Towers, and he bought into it all, but then after a few months he kind of eased off on that. He never went public with it, but you know, that's why I call him it was a truther in reverse. He was like a truther before there was even anything like a truther. You know, the truthers came around like 2 or 3 years afterwards, but he was immediately after the plane hit. We were aghast. This congressional staff, we were just, our jaws dropped. We were sitting there watching the images on CNN and Fox News of people jumping out of the 110th floor of the Twin Towers. And here's our boss, the guy that we're working for, busting our behinds 10 or 12 hours a day, blaming George President Bush for it, you know? The story on that is that the resolution came up to vote to go into Afghanistan. And I'll tell you, and I'll swear in a stack of Bibles on this, he did not want to vote for that. He absolutely did not want to vote for that resolution. It only took the threat of our entire congressional district staff of resigning to get him to vote in the final hours to vote yay on that resolution.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you, I'm amazed that he did, hearing everything that we're hearing about him and that you're telling us, and it certainly is very consistent what we know about him. I'm actually shocked that he did it. He probably regrets it.
Well, he was telling us, and Tom Lozardo, our chief of staff, were telling us days ahead of that vote to get prepared in the congressional offices, in the district offices in Victoria and San Marcos near Austin and in Freeport near Houston, that we were going to have a huge counter-reaction from the constituency for Ron's vote. There was only one congressperson that voted nay on that, and that was Tammy Baldwin from Wisconsin. And he was kind of friends with her. And he was going to be the Republican. They had it planned out. He was going to be the Republican no vote on it, and he was going to be the Democrat no vote on it. Now, here's an interesting historical factoid. There was one congresswoman that actually voted against the intervention in World War II, the declaration of war, and I forget her name. I think she might have been from Kansas or something. Ron just adored this woman. You know, she was like his idol. You know, she was the one lone vote against fighting Hitler, you know, and fighting, going into the fight the Nazis in Germany. And she was so principled. She stood up, you know, she had 434-1. And he was planning to be like her. But at the last minute, for purely practical political reasons, and let me say something else. His family was against him on this, too. Oh, my God, his wife, Carol, was just beside herself. Ron, you can't. There's no way you can do that. How can you do that? Rand Paul, the senator now from Kentucky, he couldn't believe it. You know, he was telling his dad, don't you dare do this. His entire family was against him on this. But Joe Becker, the legislative director who was under the thumb of Lou Rockwell, down in Auburn, Alabama, at the Ludwig von Mises Institute, and Norman Singleton, who's the legislative director, they were saying, go, Ron, do it. And like I said, like the last couple hours, we all thought he was going to vote no on it, and he did end up changing his vote.
Getting back to my earlier question about isolationism, I really just fail to understand how you can be an isolationist and say, let's stay out of everybody's business, but in the same breath say, oh, except for Israel, because I wish they didn't exist, and I wish we could divide them up, give them back to the Arabs, and just remove all the Jews from Israel. Can you get back to that?
Well, I guess I was going to answer it this way. Have you ever noticed that when Ron, and I'm a libertarian, and I'm against foreign aid, and I know there's probably a lot of Jewish people out there listening to this that are probably aghast at that. You know, I would cut off foreign aid across the board, but it wouldn't be one of the first things I cut. You know, I get rid of stupid things like PBS and National Endowment for the Arts and stuff like that, and NPR. I mean, that foreign aid would be way down the list.
And let me tell you, as a Jew, I don't necessarily agree. I don't agree, but I respect it if you're consistent. I don't view it as being such an absurd, ridiculous position.
Okay, now here's my question. Have you ever noticed that when Ron Paul talked about cutting foreign aid, it's always Israel? Yeah, have you ever heard him lead off and say, you know what, we need to cut off aid to Turkey and Egypt and Morocco and America's neighbors.
And Pakistan.
No. And Pakistan, yeah. No, it's always, we need to cut aid to Israel. You know, if you read his newsletters, if you see what he said all over the years, it's only when he's pressed.
And he claims that they'll be better off, by the way. He claims Israel will be better off without the aid. I'm not sure what his rationale is.
Well, that may be the case, but what about Turkey, Ron? What about Egypt and Morocco and Pakistan? Will they be better off without our foreign aid as well? He doesn't seem to care about that.
So how do you explain that?
You know, say that again?
Yeah, how do you explain that? I really don't get it. Again, unless he has some sort of gripe with the Jewish people, how do you explain that?
I don't really want to go there. I just don't want to think to myself that I actually worked for a guy like this for so long, and I thought better of him, and I thought that I could change him and bring him around. So maybe I'm just, I don't know, maybe you're right. Maybe there is something more there.
I'll tell you, you're repenting for the working for him, and look, we respect that. I really, it takes a lot of courage to do what you're doing. But if you just look at all the facts,
really? You say it takes a lot of courage to do what I'm doing. I'll tell you what, Mike, it's lucky that you got through to me on the phone, because all the Ron Paul people, they have texted me vicious, you know, vulgar, and I'm a Navy guy, so I can take vulgarity. All day yesterday, my phone, I think my max for cricket is like 150 text messages. I got 150. You know, and they're all vulgar, and I mean, I'm getting slammed by all these Ron Paul bots all on my email and everything, and they're calling me up, and that's why when you originally called me, I was a little suspicious, because, you know, all day long, that people are calling me up, and they're, is this Dondero? You know, how could you do this to Ron Paul, blah, blah, blah.
You asked me if I was a friend or foe. I felt so bad for you at that moment. I can't even imagine what you're going through. But again, I just want to run through the facts here, and I think you're seeing the point that I'm driving at, and I don't know. I'm not claiming anything. I'm just asking the questions. But wouldn't have gone into World War II, let Hitler kill 6 million Jews, that's none of our business. Let Iran build a nuclear weapon, that's none of our business. But somehow, when it comes to Israel and Hamas, Israel helped create Hamas. Israel would be better off if we stopped giving them money, and the United States would be better off if Israel never existed. So if I could do what I wanted to do, let's get rid of Israel, abolish the entire country, and give it back to all the Arabs. Suddenly there, he is minding other people's business. And as you said, when he talks about cutting off aid, it's always Israel, Israel, Israel. You put it all together, and you know, it's very hard to not see a certain picture of what's going through Ron Paul's head.
Yeah, I guess I agree. I mean, and unbelievably, I mean, the voters in Iowa aren't really reacting to this. What does this say about the state of Iowa? I mean, my gosh. I don't think Ron Paul's going to do well in New Hampshire at all. I mean, you know, he might get fourth place or something, but my God, what is going on with the brains of the people in the state of Iowa? Are they really isolationists?
It's staggering.
They're not.
I don't believe most of them are. They're just so enthralled with his message on the economy, and they're suffering so much because of President Obama that they're willing to just ignore all the foreign policy stuff, which itself is extremely frightening, the fact that they would just overlook it. But that's what I have to believe. He's doing a good job at persuading them on the domestic stuff. Maybe there are some out there that are isolationists, but not 18 or 20%, the numbers that he's getting. It's really a very scary situation, which is why we need a person like you, Eric Dondero, who's blowing this whistle. And we need you to say it in the strongest terms as you have been, because I've been screaming about this on my show for months. The fact that he's able to become this mainstream Not only is he not a mainstream Republican, you told me earlier, he's not even a mainstream libertarian. And yet, his message is striking a chord with mainstream America. It's very, very scary.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, I'm getting precious little support from anybody. I don't want you all to cry me a river, but I'm pretty much by myself on this. There's a small handful of Jewish libertarians. I got to mention Bruce Cohen out in California, and a couple others who are helping me out and backing me up on this. And some of these people used to support Ron, and they're now, you know, they've got a Facebook page, you know, Stop Ron Paul. But besides that, we're pretty much, I've been pretty isolated on this. I've been, you know, I didn't expect this to go that far. I just sent a statement to some conservative bloggers that I knew because they had been asking me these questions, and I thought it would stop there. But I guess somebody got a hold of it, and just, man, it's been crazy ever since. So
yeah, look, well,
I guess I'm saying I could use some support from the Jewish community. You know, y'all help me out here. I mean, because I am getting hammered by, I mean, these Ron Paul people are just attacking me and just for coming out like this and questioning my credibility and saying all sorts of wild and crazy stuff, like I was fired from his staff, which is complete BS.
I wanted to give you a chance to respond, you know, to that.
Anybody can call Tom Lizardo up. He's the former chief of staff, and then you can ask Tom, did Eric resign or did he get fired? I resigned over a period of 6 months. It took me to resign. Understand, I'd been working for this guy longer than anybody else on the staff, twice as long as anybody else. And it was a tough divorce between him and I. There was a period of about 6 months where we did not even talk to each other, believe it or not. And I go back and forth. I said, Ron, you know, I'm going to resign. And then he didn't want me to resign. He said, no, just stay on a few more weeks. We'll resolve this and stuff like that. And then Tom finally came to me and said, you know, dude, man, this you worked for this guy. This can't go on. Something's got to happen, you know. And I said, Tom, you know, I tried to resign, but he didn't want me to. But I'm going to resign right now. I'm going to type up a letter, and that'll be it. And I did, and Tom accepted the letter, and he presented it to Ron, and that was the end. Now, I'll tell you something else. After I actually left the office and officially resigned, I think it was in January of 2004, he called me twice at home and sarcastically said, "Aha, you'll be back. You'll be back. You always come back." See, I had resigned before too in 2001, and I had left his staff. Or it was 2000. And I left for a whole year, and they tracked me down in Mexico. I was teaching English in Mexico, and they asked me to come back. So I mean, all this stuff that Jesse Benton's putting out, and this guy came on board like in 2007. So how the hell would he know? All the stuff that he's putting out, that Eric Dondero is just a disgruntled former employee that got fired, is total bunk. Yeah, I'm disgruntled. I'm disgruntled about his foreign policy, not about him personally. I mean, him and I were friends for many, many years. And, geez, I still got his banana trees in the back of my backyard that he personally came to my house and planted. So, I mean, it wasn't a personal thing. It wasn't disgruntlement over him personally. It was a disgruntlement over his foreign policy. So.
All right, that's really incredible. We're going to have to end it there. Eric Dondero, 12-year advisor for Congressman Ron Paul, libertarianrepublican.net. I do want to just leave you with this thought. I really believe that if we keep at it, and if you keep at it, the mainstream media right now, maybe they don't even want to, but they're being forced to pick up on this, as you mentioned before, and like we've seen in other instances with the whole Dan Rather fiasco when he spread stuff about President Bush that wasn't true. If we keep at it with the new media, the mainstream media will eventually have no choice, and I really believe that this thing is going to explode. So we commend you for everything you're doing.
Do I have time to make just one quick statement?
Yes.
On that? I think the mainstream media is in a tough position because they sort of halfway agree with Ron on foreign policy. So they don't want to really attack him on this. They're coming around because they've been forced into this position, But who knows? I tend to think a lot of them are liberal, and they agree with leftist foreign policy, which Ron has. So I think they're walking on the
tinder
boxes here.
It's a very good point.
Anyway, well,
great
Thanks
point.
Thanks for having me. It's been great.
It's been a pleasure. And, Eric, we will actually be coming back to you for updates as this whole thing continues to unfold.
Yeah. All right. Good deal. Thank you so much. And if anybody wants to find me, it's libertarianrepublican.net. Y'all take care. Good night.
Eric Dondero here on the Jake Stern Show, Yeshiva World Radio, theyeshivaworld.com.